Good evening and welcome to Hedges Baptist Church. If you'll stand, we'll be singing Living by Faith. Care not today what tomorrow may bring, shadow or sunshine or rain. The Lord I know ruleth o'er everything, and all my worry is vain. Living by faith in Jesus above, trusting, confiding in His great love. From all harm safe in His sheltering arm, I'm living by faith and feel no tempest may blow and the storm clouds arise, obscuring the brightness of life. I'm never ashamed of overcast skies. The Master looks on at the strife. Living by faith in Jesus above, trusting, confiding in His great love. From all harm safe, sheltering arm, I'm living by faith and feel no alone. Know that He safely will carry me through, no matter what evils betide. Why should I then care though the tempest may blow, if Jesus walks close to my side? Living by faith, Jesus above, trusting, confiding in His great love. From all harm safe in His sheltering arm, I'm living by faith and feel no alarm. The Lord will return to this earth some sweet day, our troubles will then all be o'er. The Master so gently will lead us away beyond that blessed heavenly shore. Living by faith in Jesus above, trusting, confiding in His great love. From all harm safe in His sheltering arm, I'm living by faith, feel no alone. Amen. Brother Dan, would you open us in prayer, please? Amen. All right, we'll be singing, Are You Washed in the Blood? Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? You washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood? In the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb. Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Walking daily by the Savior's side, are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood? In the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb. Rinsed spotless, are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Bridegroom cometh, will your robes be white, pure and white in the blood of the Lamb? Will your soul be ready for the mansion bite and be washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless, are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Hide the garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless, are they white as snow? You washed in the blood of the Lamb.
Good evening. Welcome to Hedges Baptist Church. We got some people that are away with some sickness. If you don't see someone that's usually here, just reach out to them. I'm sure they would appreciate it. Those that are watching, we are so thankful that you are tuned in with us. You can always go to our website, hedgesbc.org. You can see what our beliefs are, what we are as a church. And we always encourage you, if you're in the Yulee area, if you're in the northeast area of Florida, come on by. We'd love to have you with us. We have our services at 10 a.m. on Sundays for Sunday school, 11 o'clock for the main service, 6 p.m. is the evening service, and Wednesday evening is our weekly prayer service. This evening we'll be in Joshua chapter 3, verses 1 through 5. We got into it a little bit last week, but there's mainly topic is the presence of God, and which we'll discuss the Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant is the presence of God when the Israelites had it with them. We are so excited about so many things going on. September 5th is something unique, something I've never been a part of, but it's something that God has laid on my heart to do. And that evening service, we're going to have something called a Life Verse Night. I've seen some other people sign up, and I'm anxious to see what God is doing in your life, as well as my life, in this church's life. And those that are watching, if you want to kind of participate and tell us a verse that means something to you, we may read a couple of them. We are a King James Version church. If you have another version that you type up, it may not be read. We do believe in the King James Bible. Missionary emphasis is September 12th. Pray now what God would lay on your heart to give. So far, God has, and I'm going to use the word, richly blessed us in so many ways. And God has blessed us as a church to take on missionaries that we have. And through us and through your giving, the gospel is being preached in the jungles of Guyana, in Mexico, some other places, the Philippines, all around the world, the gospel is being spoken of, is given out. And it's thanks to people like you, and we just want you to continue to give, and we want to know our budget for next year of what we can afford. But thank God we have always maintained giving to our missionaries, and we want to continue to do so as a church. The last Sunday evening of the month will be our Lord's Supper communion evening. In this church, we do it as one evening. We focus on the whole night, remembering what Jesus did for us. If we're going to have the ushers this evening, and we'll pray over the offering. Brother Derek, will you bless the offering?
Dear Lord, Heavenly Father, we come to you. Thank you, dear Lord, for all that you do for us. We want to pray for this offering tonight. We want to pray that you bless the gift of the giver. We want to pray that you touch the preacher as he brings your word.
Amen.
All right, we'll be singing. Everybody will be happy over there.
The happy land of promise over in the great beyond. Saved of arrows and soon the glory share. When the souls of men shall enter and live on forevermore, everybody will be happy over there. Everybody will be happy, will be happy over there. We will shout and sing his praise. Everybody will be happy over there. Fathers, sisters, brothers will be singing round the throne in a land where no one ever knows a care. And the Christians of all ages will join in the triumph song. Everybody will be happy over there. Everybody will be happy over there. We will shout and sing his praise. Everybody will be happy over there. Hear nobody praying and no mourning in that land, for no burdens there will be for us to bear. All the people will be singing, glory, glory to the Lamb. Everybody will be happy over there. Everybody will be happy over there. We will shout and sing his praise. Everybody will be happy over there. Meet the one who's there and who kept us by his grace and who brought us to that land so bright and fair. We will praise his name forever and we look upon his face. Everybody will be happy over there. Everybody will be happy over there. We will shout and sing his praise. Everybody will be happy over there.
Amen.
Anything situated in Joshua chapter 3. Kind of stopped at the Ark of the Covenant. There's so much
going on. One of the first messages I ever preached was on the Ark. The first message I preached here as a fill-in was about the Ark of the Covenant, and we may talk about those verses in a few moments. But the Ark of the Covenant is the presence of God. Let's go ahead and read, and we'll get into just a few moments of a recap and what's going on here. Joshua chapter 3, verse 1 through 5. And Joshua, early in the morning, and they removed from Shittim and came to Jordan, and he and all the children of Israel rode and lodged there before they passed over. And it came to pass after 3 days that the officers went through the host. And they commanded the people, saying, when ye see the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God, and the priests, the Levites, bearing it, then ye shall remove from your place and go after it. Yet there shall be a space between you and it, and 2,000 cubits by measure come not near unto it, that ye may know the way by which ye must go, for ye have not passed this way heretofore. And Joshua said unto the people, sanctify yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you. Lord, we're so thankful that you even allow us. You made a way. When man broke fellowship, you made a way for us to come back into your presence. And if we just fully understand what that means for us and the love that you have for every living soul, Lord, help us this evening understand what your presence means, how much we need it, and what else comes with it.
Lord, this church, this country, our homes need your presence more than ever today. Lord, we need your presence to guide us and direct us. We need your presence Lord, I'm just astonished of how far we have put a gulf between you and us. And Lord, I'm thanking for this country specifically that you draw us even closer to you and realize it's your presence that's lacking. But Lord, you may restore it. And Lord, that's what I pray for this evening, that you instill in our hearts to have your presence in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. We're in the book of Joshua, and with everything going on in the world today, and not to give too many details, but our son Josh, most of you know, is in the Air Force, and he's assigned to a specific plane. When I saw that that plane was going, I called him just to, Joshua, you may not be able to say where you're at or what you're doing, but I'm praying for you. But I was overjoyed when I got to FaceTime him, and he's still in England. And he said, Dad, they did come around and ask me if I knew Arabic, and I told him I didn't. So,
you took that class, huh?
But God bless America. And we take that too lightly. And may God still be with our forces. The presence of God is what we're talking this evening. And all that's going on here, Joshua is now in command. God has placed him there. Before it was Moses. And if you look up their names and you study their names, Moses means to draw out. God was drawing the people close to him. And with Joshua, we see the way of salvation. We see the plan of salvation. We see that salvation has taken place. He has delivered them from the land of Egypt. And Joshua has specific orders for them now. And we got into it last week. That word shittim means, if I can look it up real quick, acacia, which means it's a beautiful flower, but with that flower comes a lot of shrubs, and if you go to pick that flower, you're going to more or less scar yourself. We got into that sin looks appealing, but if you get involved, it's going to scar you for life. And that we are to abstain from sin. And Joshua rose in the early morning, is talking about salvation. And once you're saved, God has removed sin from your life. And therefore, we should abstain ourselves from that old life. And come to Jordan, it means descendants, the descender. If you look up Jordan, God has placed you in among other children of God. Once you're saved, God has placed you somewhere. And automatically, I know our mind's going to go to a physical place, but other than a physical place, God puts you in a different spiritual place. And opens your eyes spiritually. I've had a lot of phone calls this week, and I'm thankful for it. I had a lot of phone calls. I kind of harp hard that God gives you a purpose, and I got a few phone calls this week. Well, Pastor, how do I know what my purpose is? Where God has placed you, first of all, are you saved? And where God has you now, are you able to honor him? Are you able to give him glory? And I know a lot of us, God has blessed us with where you're at, and God has blessed you with a job, but we need to think spiritually. And what I'm about to say is, not only does God want you to provide for your family with the employment that he's given you, but there's a bigger purpose where he has you. He wants you to glorify his name where you're at, to give the gospel where you are. So in your purpose, if you have a question about it, are you in a place where God can be glorified? Are you in a place where you can share what God has given you? And we need to realize that God has put us in a different spiritual place. Therefore, we should start thinking spiritually. So as we're here in verse 1, Joshua means salvation. In the morning, that means it's the start. When you get saved, it's the start, it's the beginning of something. God has placed us on a journey. God has placed us somewhere. And more than anything, I need us to realize that God has placed us in a different spiritual place. And to remove from Shittim, which means sin, and they came to Jordan, and all the children were lodged there before they passed over, which means before we go to the other side, before we cross that river, before we go into Beulah land, we're here. And there's a place that God has placed you here and wants to use you before you cross over. And we got into that a little bit. And they lodged there before they passed over, which means that I don't know how much time we have, but here they have 3 days. I don't know what our time limit is. But the time that God has given us, we are to teach others about him. And you see that in verse 1 and through verse 5, that it is set up already, and it's God who set it up. There are priests, and there are people I want to call petitioners. This evening, the Ark of the Covenant, I have like 4 or 5 pieces that's going to explain the Ark of the Covenant. And number one, if you haven't caught on, I haven't said it, but it's the presence of God. The Ark of the Covenant is the presence of God. The Ark of the Covenant is also the promise of God. God has promised us that we are and we will have eternal life. He promised Israel that we are going to cross over into that promised land. In verse 2, and it came to pass after 3 days, the officers went through the host. And these officers mean scribes. It also means priests. And what I'm saying is, and thank God for this, God has an order to things. If you haven't heard me say that, God has an order. Where God has placed you, when you got saved, God placed you somewhere. And just like Israel, God has placed you somewhere where you can be taught by someone else that's more mature in the Word of God. And God will lead you somewhere. And that somewhere, if you don't pick on it, is church. And God already has, already in place, once you've been saved, that he wants you to go to a place. A place that talks about his promises. A place that has, and I'm getting ahead of myself, but petitioners. And what a petitioner does is they uplift you. They give you strength. They speak on your behalf. They teach you, so to say. In verse 2, and it came to pass after 3 days, the officers went through the host. When we get saved, we are to go through this world and teach others about God. Plain and simple. And where you are, God has placed you. And he placed you there just as he placed Israel. Again, this is an order to things. As soon as you get saved, God has placed me, and I think about the people that he has brought in my life, that when I got saved, God has placed me somewhere. Not only spiritually, but he placed me also physically into a church. And God has placed a petitioner in my life. And if you think about your life, if you're saved, he's done that for you as well. And you need to go where God places you. It's for your benefit. And God will do this after you're saved, when you have the presence of God in your life, when you have that promise. God will place some petitioners in your life. In verse 3, and they commanded the people, saying, when we see the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God and the priests, the Levites, bearing it, that he shall remove your place and go after it. The Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of Promise. God has shown them, when you get saved, I'm presently in your life to show you about, not just tell you about my promise, but to show you that my promise is real. That I'm not going to leave you nor forsake you. And that word ark, if you look it up, it's a vessel. And in the New Testament, we are that vessel. We hold God in us once we are saved. But the Ark of the Covenant is a vessel, and it's specifically, when you look it up, it's a vessel of protection and safety. From now on, when you're saved, you have and you've been placed into protection. Think of it as you will, as someone's elected as a president, that you have secret service. God has secret service all around you. He's got his angels all around you. You have his protection once you're saved. You have that promise of safety. The word of God is inside the ark. If you read carefully, there's different places in the Bible what tells you exactly what's in the Ark of the Covenant. And you'll see that it's manna's in there from what they ate. And the word of God is in there. And there's a few items that I have to look up, but there's a few more items that Aaron had that's in there. But specifically, the word of God is inside the Ark of the Covenant. And when you look at the Ark of the Covenant, I was thinking about this the other day. When you see the Ark of the Covenant, and you see it being held up, and you see it in pictures, and it gives us the dimensions of what it looked like, and it had pallbearers. It reminded me of a coffin. The Ark of the Covenant reminds me of a coffin. That means that they had a coffin with them that traveled with them. And to me, it was kind of a symbol showing that Jesus was going to die. And he was going to have victory in that death. But as you look at it, I can see a coffin that they traveled with, that Jesus was inside, that Jesus was going to die for their sin, and that he was going to resurrect from the grave. And we know that the Ark of the Covenant is a symbol of righteousness. As long as you have the presence of God in your life, you're going to do right. God's going to put you on the right path. The Ark of the Covenant was placed in the tabernacle, in a temple. And if you think about it, in the New Testament, our body is a temple of God. So once you're saved, the presence of God is in you. And when I got saved, the Word of God, Jesus, is inside me. And God is in you, and God has the Ark of the Covenant for them. He has the presence in them to guide them. Once you're saved, God is inside you to guide you. So you know what that means? It means you do not know where you're going. God does. You don't have a clue. And I'm talking to saved people, and Scripture talks to saved people when it says that our ways are not his ways. Amen. And we need to acknowledge that. And the sooner the better. I'm so glad it's in this verse, in this, the way it's in order, that once you're saved, you need to realize God needs to guide your life. You can't do it. God has placed you somewhere where he can guide your life. But some of us want to go someplace else. When God is placing you somewhere where you need to be, when you should be. But God is with them. He's guiding them. And you know what he's telling them? Stay the course. Stay the course. And we got into it last week. Kind of imagine that there were millions of them. And I brought up that as I was growing up, I lived in a two-bedroom house, and we stayed the course. Amen. Don't leave until God leads you somewhere else. But if God has placed you somewhere, I don't care if it's up to your standards or not. It's up to God's standards. Hey. When I didn't have any of his notes, but speaking to Josh, sometimes I need to humble him. And I'm glad he's in the Air Force, don't get me wrong. But he said, Dad, if I'm ever stationed someplace else, we get paid more because it's not up to our standards. Where God places you, it's not by your standards. by his standards. And sometimes we don't want to go where God leads us because it's not up to our standards. Where God has you is the best place you can ever be. It will benefit you more than you'll ever know. There's a reason, there's a purpose, and what God is showing us and what he's showing the children of Israel, you need to endure this. You need to stay the course where I have you. Have the presence of God in your life. And God gives you a promise. He gives you his presence. That means he shows up. By seeing the Ark of the Covenant, not only did God tell them he's with them, but they see that he's with them. But when you're saved, God is with you. His presence is in your life. So not only as you read the Word of God and you read all this, but the very Word of God is in you. He's showing you the promises by being in us once we're saved. And not just to show. He doesn't just show us. He goes, go to that place and I'm going to walk away. God is with us every step of the way. Where he places you. So how dare any of us, even me, if I ever say, God, will you have you have me, it's not up to my standards. God knows exactly where he wants us. Where he places us. And we need to be where he places us. And he'll never leave us when we're in the presence of God. And not just to show us, but he's with us every step of the way. God will sustain you where you are. Some people think that God has left them. If you're saved, he's never left you. You may have, let me get it straight though, you may have left the presence of him. You may not be where he has placed you. So maybe you need to go where he placed you. That means going back to where you should be instead of where you want to be. So the Ark of the Covenant is the presence of God, the promise of God. And not only that, it's the petitioners of God. The petitioners and representatives and ambassadors of God. You see this in verse 3. And they commanded the people, saying, when the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God and the priests and Levites bearing it, God has placed you along godly men and women. Hey, if I went around this congregation, there's no doubt in my mind I would have people say that on my journey, God has placed someone in my life. Isn't that amazing? That when you have the presence of God, you have the promise of God. That you have petitioners of God. God has placed you somewhere among mature Christians. And there's no doubt in my mind that's where God places you. I've seen it in the Bible over. I see it in my life. But when God gets a hold of you, he places you somewhere. He's going to place you in his promises. He's got his presence, and he's got petitioners with you. Those petitioners, those ambassadors, if you will, they want you, and they're there so that you stay the course. I am so glad that there are people here in our church that pray for one another. When times get bad, we have others that pray, that help people stay the course, to get through the things that God has allowed things in people's lives. But we need to keep the course and keep those around you that are in touch with God. We need to keep the company of godly people in our lives. A majority of us, and listen, I'm not targeting anybody, but some of us go off course. You know why? Because we're looking for someone that's going to agree with us. As soon as we have someone who doesn't agree with us, we want to jump ship. There are some people that call the church, and if I don't agree with them, then that's not the church I'm looking for. You just said it, what you're looking for. But we need to stay the course. We need to stay around the people that God places in our life. And I haven't brought this up in a while. I'm going to bring it up. That means If God has led someone to you to marry you, you need to keep that person in your life. If God led you to them, if God has placed them in your life, you need to keep them in your life. They're there for a reason. As I was studying this verse and studying about petitioners, I was thinking about God when he made man, he had to place a woman in man's life to help him. Imagine that. Big old macho man, God said, I'm not going to place you with another man. Thank God, and we believe that.
Amen.
God placed a woman in his life to help him. And we need to understand that, men, that our wives are there to help us. That we must include them in our lives. There is a reason why God has placed that lady in your life. And ladies, there's a reason why God has placed a husband in your life. We can't do this stuff on our own. And if God has placed someone in your life, God has placed someone that's godly in your life. And you don't need to look for someone else that's going to agree with your sinful ways of living. If you do, you're going to have just a disastrous marriage. So we have petitioners that God has placed in our life when we have the presence of God. God has placed them, let me get this straight so I don't say it wrong, an under-shepherd. God has done that. I'm not here to promote myself or like that, but God has placed someone else in your life. And we talked about this a little bit last week in Sunday school class, and I truly believe this, that God has placed people in our lives to hold us accountable.
Amen.
And if you don't have someone in your life that don't hold you accountable, you need to have someone, you need a mentor, you need someone that's not just going to agree with you. You need a godly person that's going to hold you accountable. And we got into a little bit in Sunday school last week that we don't just give missionaries, support missionaries that don't belong to boards. If we give money to them, they should be accountable. And this church holds me accountable, which you should. But I believe that God places people in our life, and one day we are going to be accountable anyway. But I believe this is the way of God is teaching us how to live and what to expect in heaven. We're going to have accountability in our life. But man, some of us, we don't like that person that God sends our way. When they tell us that what we're doing is sin, oh man, I'm going to look, and a word, I'm going to use that word I'm going to look someplace else, God. I don't feel too comfortable where this is. Well, God's not going to place you somewhere where you're going to be comfortable. I'll tell you that again. If you're comfortable in your lifestyle, that's not where God's placed you. And it's only when God places you somewhere where you're not comfortable is where he can work in your life. So God has placed officers, God has placed priests in our lives, people that are godly, more mature than us. And I thank God for that. In Israel's time, God had a prophet. Where God is, where God's presence is, he places you somewhere where there's a little godly people. And specifically, God has placed us, and thank God for it, God has placed you and wants to place you somewhere where there's a more mature Christian than you are. To show you the ropes, so to say, so you don't fall. So you keep the Christian life, so you sustain the path that God has you on. And God has done that with me. When I got saved, there was he's still the assistant pastor at Faith. His name's Dan Bewley, and he used to come to the house. And we had conversations, and we didn't hold back. I did not hold back what was going on in my life to him. And he held me accountable. Which we should have accountability. There were some not so easy conversations that we had. But I look and see where God has me now. And the reason why he had placed that godly man in my life. And every time we go there, we have some fun. He's kind of a character. I always talk about Pastor Gregory. I'll just tell you this. Pastor Gregory, I bring him up from time to time, and he would pound on his pulpit, "We need men of character, men of character," this, that, and the other. And when he retired, we had Pastor Bedrill, and he hired Dan, and I said, "We stayed true to Pastor Gregory. We hired a character." And he would just have fun. He would, you know, he was real. Didn't put on a show. And this last time we went to Michigan, we went and visited, and they kind of had self-distancing. He's like, "Come here." So we gave each other a hug, and he kissed me on the cheek, and I gave him a kiss. We're still good friends.
Amen.
He's still my mentor. We call each other up when I tell him what's going on. And there's some things that I tell him, and stay the path. Keep preaching what God's done in your life. So we need that. So don't get mad at God if he's placed you somewhere where someone's going to point out some of your faults. But they should do it in a loving, kind way, according to Scripture. God's trying to keep you honest, if I can say that word, to stay on your path. So not only does God have his presence when you accept him and his promise and petitioners, but he's got a plan for you. God has a plan for me. God has a plan for you. And they, in verse 3, and they commanded the people, saying, "When you have see the Ark of the Covenant and the Lord your God and the priests and Levites bearing it, then you shall remove from your place and go after." The plan is, first and foremost, when you're saved, go after the things of God. What does God have for you? And you're not going to know unless you have the presence of God in your life. And you're not going to have the presence of God in your life if you're not where you are placed by him. So once you're saved and you have the presence, then you have the promise, and then when you're placed in the petitioners, godly leaders, pastors, preachers in your life, then God has a plan for you. And some of us don't even get to that step. And then I see a lot of Christians, again, this week I'll have phone calls, "I don't know what God has for me." Are you where God wants you to be? I don't know. Let's back up. Are you saved? And do you have the presence of God? Because once you do, God is going to place you somewhere. And again, first and foremost, he places you somewhere spiritually. In your mind. He wants you to start thinking about spiritual things. He wants you to start studying his word. And then when you have that, God starts moving a little bit more in your life. God is moving you along. I think of this, without even realizing it, when you're close to God, I picture God just holding your hand, and you're just talking, and you're doing God's things, you don't even realize the way he's guiding you. Well, my kids were little, and they wanted me to hold their hands. And when we went to public places, there is no doubt they were going to hold our hand. They were kind of clueless sometimes where they were going. But all they knew is where dad was taking them. So as they held my hand and we would talk, they wouldn't even realize that all along, dad was guiding them. Dad was placing them where they should be. And at that age, when they're young, they didn't even know it. As soon as we get saved, we need to start having the presence of God and just holding on to him. And let him guide us and direct us. When I got down here, most of you I know, went into Trinity and was taking 20 credit hours. For most of you guys know, 12 credit hours is full time. I was taking 20. What I'm saying was, I was so wrapped up in what God was doing in my life, I didn't have time for any foolishness. I was too worried about passing Greek and studying what God had in his word. I was so wrapped up, one of the first things that God took me away from was watching football on Saturdays. Didn't even realize it. There is one moment, I kid you not, Joshua came in the room and says, "Dad, you see the score in the Michigan game?" "No, son, I don't." And it kind of puzzled him. "You're not the same dad." that I know would have had this game on an hour before the game started. What I'm saying is, when you start doing what God wants you to do, you don't even, you're automatically being programmed. And you want the things that God wants for your life. And you desire the things that God wants for you. So once you get saved, go after the things of God. He's not going to make you. He's not going to make me. But God left our instructions, left his instructions, let me rephrase that, that we are to go after the things of God. Yet there shall be a space between you and it, and 2,000 cubits by measure, and come not near unto it, that he may know the way by which it must go. For ye have not passed this way heretofore. You're on a path where you never were before. And the reason why God wants us to back up, first and foremost, to understand who he is and who we are. And God wants us in a place, he's placing them in a place where they will see his presence. You can't get in front of God. You have to be where God has you. And the place that God wants them, first and foremost, if you realize that the Ark of the Covenant had to be on the shoulders, which means that God wants you in a place where he's above you. That's where God wants you. Realizing that he's above you. But he also wants you in a place where you focus on him. That you have to be where he wants you to get the best view. The old Tiger Stadium, I can't believe they sold seats like that. I don't know if they do at the stadiums around here, but the old Tiger Stadium, the new one is beautiful. The old one actually has sold seats that said obstructed view, which means that you sat behind a pole. And it said it on the ticket. And now they have a beautiful park where, man, it's not really a bad seat in the Comerica Park. What I'm saying is God wants to place you somewhere where you see him. And realize that he's above you. And when you do that, he can guide and direct. He doesn't want your eyes off of him. What he's saying is stay with the plan. And it may be rough where God has you. It may not be up to your standards. It's up to God where he has you. There's a benefit to where he has you. God wants you to become the person that he wants you to be. There's an old story, I haven't said it in a while, but I may end with this. It's a story of a person that retired a long time ago, and he started doing a lot of yard work. And in his backyard, he saw a caterpillar that came into cocoon. And man, he never seen a transformation, the metamorphosis of a caterpillar coming into a butterfly. So he just watched that cocoon day after day. Finally, one day he saw that there was an opening, and he said, man, this is the moment. I've never seen this before, that it was coming out. And he saw that the butterfly, the caterpillar now became a butterfly, and it was struggling. And he took it upon himself, went inside the house, got a pair of scissors, and he cut the slit, and the butterfly just fell flat to the ground. What he failed to realize was it had to be tough and rough. What the hole was doing, it was specifically made to be a struggling moment for the butterfly to strengthen the wings. And because the butterfly didn't go through the struggle, it would not become the beauty. It wouldn't become all that God wanted it to be. Because someone took it upon themselves and wanted to take the easy road instead of the road that God wanted them to take. But the Ark of the Covenant is the presence of God. It's the promise of God. And I want to get to the last one, slide 5. You can just jump to slide 5. It's phenomenal. When you have the presence of God, man, it's phenomenal. In verse 5, and Joshua said unto the people, sanctify yourselves for tomorrow, the Lord will do wonders among you. God wants to place you somewhere. Will you see him work a wonder in you? And you won't be able to see it unless you're where God wants you to be. You're not going to be able to see the wonder that God has for your life unless you are on the journey that he has you on, where he places you. There's so many things. Paul and I just wonder sometimes, is wow. We go back to Michigan every so often, and we look at each other, and we always had that same look. It's like we can read each other's mind. Did we really just leave the way we did? And we think to ourselves, this was all because of God. He moved in such a way that we couldn't have done this on our own. And we look back from time to time and see the journey that God has placed us on. And we see what God has done in our children's lives. And we see where God has placed us here. And even as pastor, God has placed me with some petitioners. God has placed me in a place where others pray for me and strengthen my journey. Pastor, stay the course. There are days like you have days. And I'm careful what I say. I don't plan on going anywhere. And I'm cautious when I say these things. But there are some days, hey, Fawn, let's just pack up and go. You know, we would like to be. And again, I'm not going anywhere. This is just sometimes we talk. There's no doubt in my mind that sometimes if our children go somewhere, we want to be where our children are. Sister Lynn, I'm sure that you would probably want to be where your daughter is sometimes. But God has you here. And I'm glad you're here. The same place with some of you and your stories. And we think about it, and then somebody reaches out and, man, I've been praying for you, Pastor, and I'm just glad where God has me. We put it that way. Where God placed me is where I need to be. Amen. And it makes me wonder, and I'm in awe of what God has done and what he continues to do. And if I wasn't where God wants me, I wouldn't be able to see the amazement that God has and the wonder and the word phenomenal. So when you have the presence of God in your life, you have the presence, you have the promise, you have petitioners, you have a plan, and all that becomes phenomenal. You look back at your life, and you are where God wants you to be. You're in the place that he is. There's no doubt in my mind that you have seen some amazements in your life. You've seen some awe moments, some things that you can't describe, but glory be to God. Lord, we're so thankful for everything you've done.